morning to all of you once again, class 11 science boys. Today I will be continuing with the chapter organic chemistry, some basic principles and techniques, chapter 12. In my previous class, I remember I had explained you and taught you the IUPAC nomenclature of aliphatic compounds and aromatic compounds as well. So today, the fifth day of this chapter, 19th of July 2021, I'll be teaching you something about isomerism from this chapter. Now, this word isomerism, it is not new to you. Okay, it is an old word which you must have heard in class 10 also. Now, isomerism means when there are two or more compounds possessing the same formula, same molecular formula. The molecular formula is same, but these two compounds, they have different structural formula and different physical and chemical properties. The phenomenon is called isomerism, and such compounds are called isomers. So this is one definition which you need to understand and remember. So in short, isomerism, compounds have same molecular formula, but the structural formula is different. Because the structural formula is different, their physical and chemical properties also differ. Isomerism, it's of two types. The two types are structural and stereoisomerism. Now, let us look at structural first. In structural isomerism, you know, it is shown by compounds having the same molecular formula but different structural formula, differing in the arrangement of the atoms. That is quite easy. But under stereoisomerism, when isomerism is caused by the different arrangement of atoms or groups in space, in three-dimensional space, the phenomenon is called stereoisomerism. The stereoisomers have same structural formula but differ in arrangement of atoms in space. They might have the same structural formula. Like, for example, I can have a compound like this. Okay. Now, this is the arrangement over here. Chlorine, then iodine, then bromine. In space, it can differ in the arrangement of the four atoms which are present around it. For example, you can have a look over there. The same compound, I can write in another form also. In the center, there is obviously carbon, so I put over here. So this chlorine I can put over here, this chlorine can come down over here, the iodine can come over here, bromine can come over here. So this is something which is called stereoisomerism. The difference in the stereoisomerism is because of the arrangement of the atoms around the central atom in three-dimensional space. Again, if you see further into depth, the stereoisomerism is of two types. The first one is geometrical or cis-trans. Cis-trans. Cis, same side, trans means opposite sides. And the other one is optical isomerism. The second type of stereoisomerism is called optical isomerism. Okay, now let us look at this isomerism in a much structured manner. This chart, have a look at this chart. Isomerism, there are two types. First one is structural isomerism. The other one is stereoisomerism. Structural, they differ in the structure. Stereo, they differ in the structure in the three-dimensional open space. Okay. Now under structural, we have variety of types. One is chain, then there is position, then there is functional isomerism, metamerism, tautomerism, ring chain isomerism. Now all these chain, position, functional, metamerism, tautomerism and ring chain isomerism, they come under structural isomerism over here. On the other side, under stereoisomerism, we have geometric isomerism and optical isomerism. Now, as I have told you, in geometric isomerism, isomers differ in their spatial arrangement about a double bond. So, the main criteria for an organic compound to exhibit geometric isomerism is it should have a double bond. There should be a double bond, you know. There should be a double bond like this. Either a carbon-carbon double bond or a carbon-nitrogen double bond, depending upon the compound which you are taking into consideration. Okay, so there has to be a double bond. That is one important criteria for a compound to exhibit geometric isomerism. On the other side, if you see, isomers differ in the case of optical isomerism. The isomers differ in the arrangement of atoms in three-dimensional space, which create mirror images of each other. There are mirror images, like when I stand in front of the mirror, okay, so there is an image of myself, okay, there is an image of yourself. So that arrangement of atoms in three-dimensional space, which creates mirror images, that comes under optical isomerism, and where the mirror images are not superimposable, then the optical activity comes into consideration. So this is what we are going to discuss further in this chapter. Moving further to a similar chart, you can see a very nice, wonderful summarized chart to make your idea very, very clear. Isomerism under structural, the first type is carbon chain. Have a look at the examples with the help of bond line notation. C5H12, pentane. This is pentane. Here you can see branching is there. Here there is further branching. Iso, neo, okay, that was chain isomerism. Under position isomerism, we have butanol, CH3, CH2, CH2, CH2S, butanol. Same thing, butan-2-ol. The second carbon is branching into S group. So this is position isomerism. So what happens in position isomerism? Either the position of the functional group is different, or the multiple bond position can vary. So that comes under position isomerism. We'll be going through this in detail also. Then we have functional group isomerism, in which two compounds, the structure of two compounds differ in the presence of the functional group, though they have the same molecular formula. The molecular formula is same, but this compound, it's an alcohol, over here the structure CH3CH2OH, whereas the other one, the molecular formula is same, but it is a different functional group, that it comes under ether. Then we have over here tautomerism. It is an isomerization reaction where one is a ketone form, another is an enol form. This is due to what? Due to the movement, shifting of one of the hydrogens from either of these carbons and attaching those hydrogens to the oxygen over here. So in this case, it is an acetone. Here it is an alcohol. Okay, so that is an enol. En means there is a double bond. Ol means there is an alcohol. Okay, so these are few examples of chain isomerism types over here: carbon chain, position, functional, tautomerism. Okay, ring chain, I'll come to in detail in later on. Okay, now under stereoisomerism, you can see antezen, Zusamen, RS isomerism. Okay, EZ isomerism, the first one which I have told you in the previous slide. Okay, geometrical, optical. This is optical. Okay, now look at the Z type. In Z, Zusamen. Antezen means opposite side. Zusamen means same side of the double bond. Over here, transverse side. H is opposite side. So that is E isomer. Okay. Now, structural isomers have the same molecular formula, but different arrangement of atoms in the molecule. The compound differ in the orbital order of the atoms which are connected. Whereas in stereoisomers, have both the same molecular formula and structural formula connected in the same way, but differ in the spatial arrangement of atoms in the molecule. You can see over here, this compound over here, carbon, hydrogen in the plane of the paper, fluorine in the plane of the paper. This chlorine is towards you, and this bromine is against the paper, plane of the paper. So if you look at the other isomer, this hydrogen and fluorine are in the plane of the paper, but the bromine, which is away, is on the other side. It is on the other side. Here it is this side, here it is other side, and this chlorine is towards you. So this is how isomerism comes into effect. After that, let us go in detail quickly. The first one, first isomerism is called chain isomerism. It comes under structural isomerism. Look at the first example over here. An isomer, chain isomer, pentane. There are 5 carbon atoms, 3, 4, 5 carbon atoms, CH3, CH2, 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 CH3. So that's an example of pentane. The same compound can be written in another form also by branching one of the carbon atoms. So here the second carbon atom is branched into a methyl group. So this becomes isopentane. That is the common name. The correct IUPAC name is 2-methylbutane. 2-methylbutane. 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's 4 carbon atoms in the straight chain, 2-methylbutane. Then we have over here the third isomer over here for the compound pentane. Okay. So there is branching. The second carbon atom is branched into 2-methyl groups, either this side or this side. Okay, so the nickname, the common name is neopentane. Its correct IUPAC name is 2,2-dimethylpropane. After that, let us, I think this is clear to all of you. Chain isomerism. Chain isomerism comes under structural isomerism. Is this clear, my boys? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then come to the next one, which is called position isomerism. Now, position isomerism is also under structural isomerism. Here, either the position of the functional group is changing or the position of the multiple bonds are changing. I have given 2 examples over here. The first one you see, it is pentane-1-all. Pentane-1-all. The second one is pentane-2-all. The second carbon atom is having the functional group. In the first one, the first carbon is having the functional group. So, these are what? Position isomers. Because of the difference in the position of the functional group. Then, look at the next example over here. Butene. The second carbon atom is having an unsaturation. It's a double bond over there between the 2 carbon atoms. Whereas, in the next example, Butene, the first carbon is having a double bond with the second carbon. So, these are examples of position isomers. So, second type of structural isomerism I have explained with example. Now, let's move to the next type, functional isomerism. Okay. Now, functional isomerism also comes under structural isomerism, in which 2 compounds, they have the same molecular formula. The molecular formula is same. The molecular formula is same, but their structural formula become different because of different functional groups. Here, the functional group is an alcohol. Alcohol. Okay, it is an alcohol. Here, it is an ether. It is an ether. Okay, so functional isomerism is a type of isomerism in which the 2 compounds differ in the presence of different functional groups. So that is functional isomerism. After that, the next type of isomerism under structural isomerism is called metamerism. This one is important. This one is important. Metamerism, which also comes under structural isomerism, where this type of isomerism is due to unequal distribution of carbon atoms on either side of the functional group. This is the functional group, you see. On this side, ethyl group is there. This side, ethyl group is there. This side, 2 carbon atoms. This side, also 2 carbon atoms. But in methyl propyl ether, this side, 1 carbon atom. This side, 3 carbon atoms. So, that is how we try to understand metamerism, which comes under structural isomerism. Okay. Now, such compounds are members of a homologous series. They belong to the same homologous series. All of them should be either ether, or maybe either alcohol, it depends. Okay. Examples, very good examples over here are given. Diethyl ether or methyl propyl ether are examples of metamerism. Whatever examples I have given you, I am giving you for the what you call structural isomers, different types of structural isomers, they are important. Okay, that will help you understand the concept of isomerism clearly. Okay. Moving further to tautomerism, my dear boys, which also comes under structural isomerism. Tautomerism is called also keto-enol tautomerism because they remain in equilibrium. The two isomers, if you look at their structural formulas, they are in equilibrium. Okay, one could be a major, one could be a minor, but they are in equilibrium. Now, if you look at the first example over here, this one is acetone. Acetone is there, but here there is an alcohol in all. Okay, so the same, the molecular formula is same. If you see the molecular formula, C2H6O. Check, C2H6O, same thing, C2H6O. This one is an ketone, this one is an alcohol. Now, the ketone becomes electrophilic, okay. The enol form becomes nucleophilic. Now, this electrophilic means it reacts with nucleophiles at carbonyl carbon. It reacts with nucleophiles at carbonyl carbon. Acidic at alpha carbon, hydrogen bond acceptor. They can accept hydrogen bonds. If I bring a hydrogen over here, okay, it is accepted. Whereas enol forms in keto-enol tautomerism, they react with electrophiles at alpha carbon, acidic at oxygen hydrogen, hydrogen bond donor and acceptor both. Okay, now there is an equilibrium in this case of isomerism between the isomers. Not, it is not resonance, okay, it is just an equilibrium. Under most conditions, keto form is favored. Under most conditions, what is there? Keto form is favored. This form is favorable, it is dominant, okay, it is more available in a solution mixture. Okay, important for aldehydes, ketones. It is important only for aldehydes and ketones mostly, but not so important for carboxylic acids, esters, amides under normal conditions. Okay, that is clear. Okay, now I hope tautomerism is clear. Briefly, only the brief example I am trying to explain you. Then moving further to the next type of structural isomerism, which is called ring chain or structural isomerism. They have the same molecular formula. If you look at this compound, the structures, they will have the same molecular formula. Three carbon atoms, three, four, six hydrogen atoms. Have a look very carefully. C3H6. 3, 4, 5, 6. Here also same thing. It is CH2. Count, you will get the same molecular formula, but here one is an open chain, another one is a closed chain. So this type of isomerism normally comes under ring chain isomerism, which comes under structural isomerism. Okay, now I have explained to you, all of you, this example over here regarding the different types of isomers. Okay, now we will move to the next type of isomer which I have explained to you, which I have told you in the chart over here. This other type of isomerism after structural is called stereoisomerism, under which we will be learning in detail geometrical and optical isomerism. In geometrical, I have told you the main condition is the presence of a double bond. But in optical, there is no need of double bond. Only the central carbon atom should have four different groups around it. That means the structural formula of the compound should be non-superimposable mirror images. So let's move and have a look at stereoisomerisms as well. Now, looking at the next slide over here, stereoisomers, the key definition over here, molecules with the same structural formula, they have the same structural formula, but with different arrangement of atoms in space. I have put a very good example over here, have a look. A very good example you can see on the screen over here. This compound you can see, there is a carbon-carbon double bond. Okay, hydrogen is here, chlorine is here, hydrogen is here, chlorine is here. If you look at this very carefully, above the double bond, the hydrogen and the chlorine, they are on the same side, but they are different atoms, different elements. Below the carbon-carbon double bond, again chlorine is there, hydrogen is there. Okay, so this is one formula which can be written for the compound. Now, if you look at the second example over here, the other isomer, below, above the carbon-carbon double bond, the chlorines are on the same side, hydrogens are on the same side. Okay, so this could be trans, this could be cis, it depends. Okay, now, this is one key definition for the structural formula under stereoisomerism. Remember that structural isomers are molecules with the same molecular formula but a different structural formula in three-dimensional space. Okay. Now going to the specific examples under this heading, let us see geometrical isomerism which comes under stereoisomerism. Let us look at the clear examples over here. Clear examples, distinct examples, specific examples. Look at the first one, cis-2-butene, cis. Cis means same side over here. The methyl groups are on the same side of the double bond. You see double bond is carbon-carbon. Below that, the methyl groups are on the same side. Hydrogen atoms are on the same side. So this is called cis-2-butene, cis-2-butene, cis. Okay. The other isomer over here, it is called trans-2-butene. Trans-2-butene, you see, above the double bond, carbon-carbon double bond, one is hydrogen atom, another one is the methyl group. Below it, again, opposite side to this carbon atom, opposite to the methyl group, there is another methyl group. Okay, so this is opposite, hydrogen is opposite, so this is called trans-2-butene. Now here, methyl groups on opposite sides of the double bond, here methyl groups on the same side of the double bond, which is called cis. Cis isomer, this one is a trans isomer. So I think geometrical isomerism which comes under stereoisomerism is clear to all of you. Now moving further to optical isomerism now, which is coming under stereoisomerism, you can see there is a compound over here, structure you can see very clearly, COH CH CH3. This compound common name is lactic acid. It is called lactic acid. Lactic acid as well. It is also called lactic acid. Boys, can you see?
Yes, sir.
Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. There was a connection problem. I think it stopped presenting. Now I think you can see. Now under optical isomerism, stereoisomerism, if you see very carefully, these two compounds are same. Only if you see, this is a carboxylic acid group. This is hydrogen atom, this is methyl group, and this one is hydroxyl group. Okay, so around this carbon atom, four different groups are there around it. And if you look at the arrangement, methyl is here, OH is here, hydrogen is here, COH is here. If you put a mirror over here, you will get a mirror image of this compound. Now, this mirror image is non-superimposable. It is non-superimposable. Like, what is the meaning of non-superimposable? If you keep your hand, the left hand and the right hand, if you have your left hand like this, these are the fingers, okay? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay, this finger, and you bring your right hand now, bring your right hand, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, and right hand over here like this, okay, look at them, these are not non-superimposable. If you try to keep on top of each other, it is non-superimposable. So this is one characteristics which comes under optical isomerism. Optical isomerisms, they have non-superimposable mirror images. Now, there is a special name given to this carbon. This carbon which is in the center having four different groups around it. This carbon is called chiral. It is called chiral carbon atom. Try to put this in your mind. It is called what? It is called chiral carbon atom. Are you getting it, boys? The carbon atom, which is having four different groups around it, it is called chiral carbon atom. And that chiral carbon atom is the very important condition for a compound to show some optical activity. When I say optical activity, means a compound which is optically active, it is capable of rotating the plane of polarized light either in the clockwise direction or in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so the carbon atom has to be chiral, or it is called asymmetric chiral, what you call asymmetric carbon. This carbon is asymmetric, it has no plane of symmetry, it has no point of symmetry. Okay, so that I'll be talking in detail after some time. Okay, now have a look further. Okay, look at another example over here. The same thing in a proper manner. Okay, have a look. Okay, just a second. Okay, now for some molecules, the mirror image is a different molecule. The mirror image is non-superimposable. Okay, what I was talking just now, it is same lactic acid. This is also lactic acid. This lactic acid you will find in our muscles, but this lactic acid you will find in sour milk. When milk turns sour, you will find this lactic acid. Minus sign is there. Minus sign. There is plus sign. Plus sign, you can call it dextro. Dextrorotatory. This you can call it levo. L-A-E-V. Levorotatory. Levorotatory means this lactic acid, minus lactic acid, if you pass plane polarized light. Light normally, if light is falling on your body, it is vibrating in all the directions. All directions. But plane polarized light means light vibrating in only one direction like this. Only one direction like this. This is called plane polarized light. So if you pass plane polarized light to minus lactic acid, this plane polarized light will be rotated in the anti-clockwise direction, in the left. It will be rotated this way. It will start vibrating this way. Okay. But if you pass this light through dextro, it will be rotated in this manner. In this manner, okay. That is how we try to understand levo and dextro rotatory in optical isomerism. Okay. Now let's make this idea very clear in our next slide. Optical activity, physical property. Optical isomers show an interaction with light. When a beam of plane polarized light, see, on polarized light, you pass this light through a polarizer, the light becomes plane. It becomes plane. It starts vibrating in one plane only. Now this plane polarized light is now passed through the organic compound. The organic compound is kept in a container over here, and it is passed, and you will find once it comes out of the organic compound, there will be an angle of rotation. Specific, it can be 30 degrees, it can be 15 degrees, it can be 40, 60, whatever angle, and that is observed on the other end by the observer. So when a beam of plane polarized light passes through a solution of optical isomers, they rotate the plane of polarized light. So this is optical activity. Now for an organic compound to be optically active, it is very important that that organic compound contains a chiral center. Contains a chiral center. When I say chiral center, I mean that carbon should have four different groups around it. Four different groups around it. Okay. It should have four different groups around it. Okay. Now, let me explain this by an example. Okay. By an example, just for the sake of making you understand. If I draw this diagram over here, carbon, hydrogen and fluorine on the plane of the paper, and I can put one more atom over here, bromine, away from you, and this chlorine towards you. This is chlorine towards you. Okay, so this compound, if you see, this carbon has got four different groups around it. So it is definite that this carbon is called a chiral carbon. It is called a chiral carbon. It has no point of symmetry. It has no plane of symmetry. So this compound is going to be optically active. It is going to be optically active. How do I come to know? If I place a mirror over here, then I will get something like this. Carbon in the center, hydrogen here only, fluorine comes this side, the bromine comes this side, and the chlorine comes here. Okay, so you can see these two compounds, they are non-superimposable mirror images. So that is one condition for a compound to be optically active. These are called enantiomers. Okay, now let us look at the other slide over here to make your idea more clear regarding optical isomerism. That's how a diagrammatic cartoon polarimeter looks like. You know, light source is here, unpolarized light is here, polarimeter, this is polarized light. There's a container in which the organic compound is kept. Okay, and then after it comes out, there is an eyepiece over here. Okay, and the observer's eye is over here. So that is how we decide and calculate by what angle, the plane polarized light is rotated. So it can be measured. That calculation formula I'll give you in the next class. Now, number A, light source produces light vibration in all directions. So it is given over here very clearly. Number B, polarizing filter allows through light vibrating in one direction only. Number C, plane polarized light passes through the sample, organic sample. If substance is optically active, it rotates the plane of polarized light. But if the substance is not optically active, then it will not rotate the plane of polarized light. That is very important to understand. Then analyzing filter is turned so that light reaches to a maximum. Okay. Then direction of rotation is measured coming towards the observer in this optical polarimeter. So that is how we are going to understand optical isomerism. Okay. Looking at the next slide, again it is the same similar diagrammatic representation. So this is how you can keep a slide over here or a protector sort of thing in a circular fashion to measure the degree of rotation of plane of polarized light. Now have a look at this slide over here. Chiral, left hand and the right hand. If you keep those on top of each other, the palm facing towards you, they cannot be superimposed. So such situation, the compound is optically active, they can rotate the plane of polarized light. But if you look at achiral objects, then achiral objects over here, like a bottle, an empty bottle like this, okay, it will not rotate the plane of polarized light. It will never. Are you getting it? So that has to be kept in mind. Okay. Now look at the left hand over your right hand. It can be superimposed. So that time it is achiral. So it cannot be superimposed. Okay. Now it is already 9-7. Now I want you all to refer to your textbook's page number. Let me write the page number in your text in the slide over here. For understanding optical activity in better detail, if you look at page number 667, page number 666 onwards, you will find plenty of examples under optical isomerism and geometrical isomerism and the conditions for geometrical isomerism. I have already mentioned you the most important condition for geometrical isomerism is that compound should have a double bond. It should be having a carbon-carbon double bond. And the most important criteria for a compound to be optically active is it should have a chiral carbon center. The carbon center should be chiral. That means the carbon center should have four different groups around it. That is the important condition for a compound to be optically active. A carbon atom whose four valences are satisfied with four different carbon atoms, it is called an asymmetric carbon. That you have to keep in mind. Okay. Now, since it's already almost time, you can just mark page number 670, 670, 671 for
sir,
understanding. Yes,
in our new book it's not there in this page number.
Okay, then if it is not there, then just look for the headings over there. Elements of symmetry, heading optical isomerism, wherever you find that. no space. Got it? You'll find optical isomerism, you'll find cause of optical activity on one of those pages. It is on which page? Tell me, cause of optical activity. I think it is on page 700.
Sir, 730.
Okay, good. Mine is an old book. I have not got the new book. Okay, never mind. So I think this is clear. So we'll continue in the next class in much more detail about optical isomerism, talking about racemic mixture or DL mixture. Okay, so I would like to end my class here only because of this already time. Okay, now I think you can leave the class. Okay, if you want to. You can leave the class. Okay.